I don't know if you know this or not, but God's an artist too. The reason I know that is because we're created in God's image and we are creative. We get our creativity from Him. And much like a dancer who is trying to communicate some deep truth through his art form, God had some certain deep truths He wanted us to get. And so He employs various art forms. Now, He was restricted to the written word. And so in His creativity, He figured out ways through the written word to use art to convey important truths to us. Let me give you an example. The resurrection. Resurrection. A dead person coming back to life. It is a theme. It is a thread all the way through Scripture. And God uses all different art forms to convey this incredibly important truth to us. Let me give you a couple examples. In the prophecy called Ezekiel, it's about the prophet Ezekiel. Ezekiel talks about the fact that one day God kind of took him to a valley. We don't know if it was a vision or a trance or if he literally went to a valley. We're not sure. But God painted this word picture, and it went something like this. Ezekiel said, God took me to the valley and showed me a bunch of dry bones. This valley was just full of bones. They were dried. They were all broken apart. And God said to Ezekiel, preach to the dry bones. Most preachers can relate to that feeling. Preach to the dry bones. What do you want me to say, Lord? Tell them to live. And so he obeyed and he preached to the dry bones and he said, dry bones live. And there before his eyes, he said the bones started to rattle and they started to pull together, and then ligaments and sinew and muscle and flesh started to join together. And all of a sudden the breath of the wind came and breathed into the bodies and they stood up and there was a vast army and the dead had become alive. Resurrection. An incredible word picture. God's a poet too. There's a lot of examples of great poetry in the Old Testament. Some of them point to the resurrection. One of my favorite poems is in the book of Isaiah. This is written 800 years before Jesus was even born, but it's describing his death and his resurrection as though it had already happened. Incredible poetry. Listen. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied. By knowing him, my righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their sins. Beautiful poetry. As we work through Scripture, the art forms become more dramatic. And as we get into the New Testament, God uses dramatic presentations. He's the producer of a great drama. Now, any great drama has tension, right? And so there was this one moment when one of Jesus' best friends, his name was Lazarus, was really sick. And he heard that he was really sick, and Jesus waits to go and see him until he actually dies. Talk about creating tension. That can create some tension. And we know that it creates tension because when Jesus finally does get to Lazarus' home, his sister shows up and meets him. If you'd have been here earlier, he wouldn't have died, she said. And he looked at her, and he said, he will live again. And she said, yeah, I know, at the resurrection at the end. And so you see, she'd seen the word pictures and she'd read the poetry, and so she knew enough about resurrection to know that one day there was gonna be some kind of resurrection for us, but she had huge gaps in her knowledge. And so Jesus filled in the gap and he looked at her in the eye and he said, I am the resurrection and the life. If you believe in me, you will live, even if you die. And anyone who does die will live. I am the resurrection and the life. They continued to talk as they got to the tomb. And when he got to the tomb, he said, okay, roll the stone away. And Lazarus' other sister said, oh, Jesus, he's been dead for 4 days. It's gonna stink. He said, I told you, if you believe, you'll see the glory of God. Now roll the stone away. So they rolled the stone away, and it's so simple, but talk about drama. Can you imagine the tension now? The stone's been rolled away. Everyone's smelling it. Jesus looks into the tomb and he says, Lazarus, come out. Pretty simple. Lazarus, come out. And then the text says, and the dead man walked out. I love that. The dead man walked out. Okay, so it should say the previously dead man walked out because he was now alive. He was resurrected. He was dead. He is now alive. Talk about drama. Can you imagine anything more dramatic than this? They were talking about it in Jerusalem for days after that. What could be more powerful than that? Well, what happened a little while later on the hill called Golgotha? The Son of Man, fully God, fully man, sacrificed himself, shed his blood, died our death on our behalf. and then was laid in a tomb. And all of a sudden, the moment that all the art had been pointing towards happens. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven and, going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. Even in this moment, there's drama and there's lights, and God's just an artist. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. And the angel said to the women, "Don't be afraid, for I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He's not here. He has risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay." Resurrection. It keeps showing up all the way through Scripture, all different forms of art. A number of years ago, Libby and I went to a play. It was a Shakespeare play. You might have heard of it. It's called King Lear. Some of you have studied it in school. And we were excited. Shakespeare's always been kind of hard for us to follow, but we'd heard that this was a special kind of Shakespearean play. And so we went, and we were not prepared for what we found. And it was a rewriting of Shakespeare's play, and all the actors were men dressed in drag with big beards, and they delivered all their lines in Japanese. I mean, King Lear's hard enough, isn't it? But seriously? We kept waiting for it to change. We kept waiting for him to say, "Just kidding," and then to do it. But no, it just kept going and going. We're just looking at each other. And we left. It's the only play we've ever left, but we left. We just couldn't imagine investing an entire evening in that. Because art has to be accessible, right? We're not all artists. So art has to be accessible. We have to get it for it to be great art. God understands that not all of us are artists, and so we might miss the word pictures and the poetry, the drama. And so on a number of pages in Scripture, he decides, you know what, I'm just going to tell them. I'm just going to come right out and tell them, because I don't want them to miss this most amazing truth called resurrection. Where does he tell us? Well, one place is in Ephesians chapter 2. This is the text I asked you to turn to, remember? Ephesians chapter 2, let me walk you through it. Paul is describing the human condition. He's describing the way life is and the way life could be. So he says, "As for you, you were dead." He's describing the way we all start. We all start spiritually dead, not in danger of dying, but really dead. A number of years ago when I was a little boy, my dad picked me up from school and he said, "We've got to stop by the funeral home." I said, "Why?" And he said, "Well, remember Rosie died." And Rosie was a young 22-year-old young woman who had had a brain aneurysm and just dropped dead at the kitchen table. And he said, "I'm doing her memorial service tomorrow, and there's a viewing, and we need to go by, and I need to meet with the people." And so we got to the funeral home. And as he's getting out of the car, he said, "Do you want to come in with me?" And I'm like, "No, I'll just stay out here." So in he went. After a few minutes, I got a little bored out there. I thought, I need to go in and see Rosie. So I got out of the car and I kind of made my way in, and I saw the little viewing room, and there's a lot of people, and so I kind of weaved my way through. And when I got up to the casket, I kind of leaned over and I looked, and I barely even recognized her. She looked totally different. She had white hair and wrinkly face, and she was all wasted away. And also my dad said, "Pete, what are you doing in here?" And I turned around and I'm looking at Rosie. He said, "Pete, that's not Rosie. She's in this other room." So went into the other room and worked my way through the people and looked up, and there was Rosie, and she looked beautiful. I was amazed at how beautiful she looked. But at that point, it doesn't really matter how beautiful you are, does it? Rosie was 22. This woman was 82. She lived a long, full life. Rosie's was nipped in the bud. But they were very similar in that room. They were both completely lifeless. Neither of them could get out of that box they were entombed in. They were incapable of doing anything. It's called dead. And that is the word that Paul uses to describe how each of us are born. Yes, we're moving around. Yes, we're living and breathing physically, spiritually, where it really matters. We are dead. What does this death look like? As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins. Transgression means to trespass. It means to go somewhere you're not supposed to go. You see a sign on a property that says, no trespassing. What it's telling you is don't go in here. So when we know we're not supposed to go and we go, that's called trespass. Sin means to miss the mark. It means to miss the target. You've got a standard. You shoot for it. You miss it. That's called sin. We do this all the time. Here we are talking about art forms, and I haven't even shared with you one of my favorite art forms, country music. It's a great art form. Because in country music, we really see into the human condition. And this whole area of trespass and sin, all over country music. You might have heard this song. And I dug my key into the side of his pretty little souped-up four-wheel drive. Carved my name into his leather seats. I took my Louisville Slugger to both headlights. Slashed a hole in all four tires. Maybe next time he'll think before he cheats. Yeah? You see that guy? That guy, he trespassed and sinned. That's what he did. There was a line. It's called fidelity. He stepped across the line, trespassed, and entered into sin. And my friends, we do it all the time. There are lines clearly drawn in Scripture. They're obvious. We step over them and we do whatever we want. And this is a manifestation of our spiritual deadness. Why would we trespass and sin? Well, we choose to because we're easily influenced. Three influences in the text. One is the world. As for you, you were dead in your transgressions and sins in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world. That's the value system of our culture. It's secular and amoral and humanistic and materialistic and greedy and promiscuous. And people see something on TV and they think, oh, that must be true. Or they read it in print media or they get sucked into the pop culture. The artists and the musicians and the movies, and they see it and they, oh, that must be reality. And the world influences us to trespass and sin. And we dive into it because we're spiritually dead. We can't stop ourselves. We're also influenced by the devil, in which you used to live when you followed the ways of this world and of the ruler of the kingdom of the air, that's Satan. The ruler of this spirit who is now at work in those who are disobedient. It's not just Satan, he's got all these spirits that are at work and people leading them into disobedience. Satan is real, my friends, and his primary goal is to keep you from experiencing God's grace. And when he loses you to his grace, then he tries to make sure you don't fully experience it, that you live in bondage even though you're saved. There's another enemy we have that influences us to trespass and sin. It's called the flesh. All of us, please note, Paul is not here pointing fingers at anyone. He's describing the place every single person starts. We're all in the same boat. All of us also lived among them at one time, gratifying the cravings of our flesh. Flesh is our self-confidence, our independence from God, and following its desires and thoughts. Let me ask you a question. Don't answer out loud. But when you're alone, when no one else is around, where do you go? Where does your thought life go? What do you do? When you're in that place where you think no one will ever know, what kinds of things do you step into? Where do your thoughts and desires go? Now, if the things that are popping into your mind are not things you'd want to share with your spouse or with your best friend, chances are those things are being generated by your flesh. Those are thoughts and desires generated by your flesh, and it's this power that influences us towards trespass and sin. And because we're spiritually dead, we're helpless. And so we get sucked into it. And you say, some of you say, you know what? Sinning's kind of fun. I'm okay with sinning. Pete, why are you so against sin? Now, it's not that much fun when someone takes a Louisville Slugger to my headlights. I mean, the consequences aren't fun. But the sin, you know, if I can get away with it, it's not all that bad. Why are you trying to spoil all our fun? Well, I want you to see the end result of this deadness. He says, like the rest, this is a universal problem, we're all experiencing it. We were by nature, this is who we are, objects of wrath, objects of God's holy reaction to evil, his anger against evil. We are objects of his wrath. It was a powerful passage speaking to the fact that we are spiritually dead. And at the risk of offending you, let me just tell you, going to church once a year doesn't change the fact that you're dead. Okay, since I offended a handful of you, let me offend everyone. Going to church 52 times a year doesn't change the fact that you're dead. In fact, going to church 104 times, just multiply it however many times you want, doesn't change the fact that you're dead. Putting money in the basket doesn't change it. Reading your Bible doesn't change it. Praying before dinner and when you go night-night doesn't change it. You're spiritually dead. Anything you do is irrelevant. You can't bring life to yourself when you're lying in a coffin. You're dead. Some of you are aware of your deadness and you're longing to get out of it. Some of you are living in your death cell and you're just trying to make it as comfortable as you possibly can. So you're filling it with TVs and cars and houses and people and success. And the deep down inside, you know there's got to be more than this. Being dead stinks. It just stinks because you're alone and you've got this void that you're always trying to fill, but no matter how hard you try to fill it, it stays empty. And so those fillings become addictions, and now you're sucked into those, and that's messing with your relationships. And there's unrest in your soul, and you're hopeless. And here's the good news. The Bible is clear that you're not in need of a restoration. You're not in need of a renovation. What you're in need of is a resurrection. You see, you don't renovate a dead person. You don't paint them with makeup and then they start living. You don't fix a dead person up. What do you need? What does a dead person need? A dead person needs life. And the only way for a dead person to get life is to be resurrected by someone else. So here's the really cool thing. The Bible isn't just pointing to the resurrection of Jesus. It's also pointing to the resurrection of you and me. You are the valley of dry bones. That's you. You are Lazarus. You're dead and you smell. And Jesus has rolled, this morning, he has rolled the stone away and he is calling to you, come out. Come out of death into life. That's what our text describes next. The next two words in the text, some of you know this, that when Paul wrote this letter, he wrote it in the Greek language. And so it's translated for us into English in our Bibles. And in the original language, when he wrote it, the next two words are very powerful. The next two words were, but God. But God. When it was translated, it comes out, but because of his great love for us, God. So they put the phrase, because of his great love for us, between but and God. But let's put it where it belongs. But God intervened. He did something. Why would he do that? Because of his great love for us. He's crazy about you. The thought of spending eternity without you is too much for him to bear. Your sin has separated you from him. He wants you. He loves you. So because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we're dead in our transgressions. It is by grace you've been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus. Okay, so Paul describes this Christian life with three words that have never been written before. He makes up three new words because he can't find any words in the Greek language that convey the power of resurrection life in Jesus. And what he did was he took a little prefix. You remember what a prefix is? That's the little word that you put on front of another word, create a compound word. And the prefix was syn, S-Y-N, and it means with. And he attached with to three words, and so it comes out, made us alive with Christ, raised us up with Christ, seated us with Christ. And in those three phrases, he describes what resurrection life is like. made us alive with Christ. This means we were resurrected with him. We don't quite understand how it all works, but if you put your trust in Jesus Christ, what happens is, as a dead person, you are in union, joined to him in his resurrection, and you are raised to new life as well. You can't bring life yourself, but he can bring it to you if you trust in him. So we are resurrected with him, which means we're no longer dead, friends. Woo! That's good news, but that's not it. We are raised up with Christ as well. This is an allusion to his ascension. Remember, after he was raised again from the dead, he hung out with his disciples for a while, then he went up on a mountain, and then he ascended. He went up into heaven. That's the concept here. We ascended with him. That means that we are no longer bound to this earth. We are no longer citizens here. We are set free from what binds us. All the bars of our death cage, all the sins and the addictions and the rules and the regulations and the stuff that binds us, we are set free from all of that. We are made alive with Christ, we are raised up with Christ, and we are seated with Christ in the heavenly realms. What does that mean? We're obviously not physically seated with him because we are here physically seated in this room. Apparently, spiritually, we are seated with him. I don't know if you remember the story of the Last Supper in John's Gospel. I think it gives us a little hint into what it means to be seated with him. Jesus told the disciples, after he celebrated the Lord's Supper with them, he told them that one of you is going to betray me. And of course, there was a lot of conversation around the table. Which one? Who is it? Who is it? And the text tells us that they called out to John, who was, quote unquote, reclining next to Christ. He was sitting next to Jesus. And when they would eat meals in those days, they didn't sit in chairs like we do. They would have a pillow, and they would put their elbow on the pillow, and then they would lay out long ways, and then they would just kind of slot in next to each other. So when you were seated next to someone, you were kind of leaned right up next to someone. So John would have been right on Jesus' shoulder. And so they knew that John was right there next to Jesus, and so the other disciples whispered, "John, ask him, who is it?" And so John said, "Lord, who is it?" This is a picture of what it means to be seated with Christ. It means that you're in the place of intimacy. It means you're in the place of revelation. It means you get to talk to him and he talks to you. You get to experience life with Jesus Christ himself. So you are made alive with him. You're no longer dead. You are raised up with him. You're no longer bound to the crud of this world, and you are brought into an intimate, deep, personal relationship with Jesus Christ. This, my friends, is better than being dead. Better than being dead. Why would God go to so much trouble? It says in verse 7, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. Why does God do all this? Because he wants to show his kids loving kindness, grace. He wants to love us. That's it? That's it. Because that's the kind of God he is. Grace is a beautiful word. It's one of our favorite words around Bent Tree. It simply means unmerited favor. It means you're given something you don't deserve. And we've shared lots of great stories over the years of grace. And I've shared this one before, but it bears repeating. It's from Brennan Manning's book, The Ragamuffin Gospel. He says, in 1986, in March, I was privileged to spend an afternoon with an Amish family in Lancaster, Pennsylvania. Jonas Zook is an 82-year-old widower. He and his children raise piglets for a living. The oldest, Barbara, 57, manages the household. The three younger children, Rachel, 53, Elam, 47, and Sam, 45, are all severely special needs. When I arrived at noon with two friends, little Elam, about 4 feet tall, heavy set, thickly bearded, remember that detail, thickly bearded, and wearing the black Amish outfit with the circular hat, was coming out of the barn some 50 yards away, pitchfork in hand. He had never laid eyes on me in his life. Yet when he saw me step out of the car, this little man dropped the pitchfork and ran lickety-split in my direction. From 2 feet away, he flung himself at me, wrapped his arms around my neck and his legs around my waist, and kissed me on the lips with fierce intensity for a full 30 seconds. Remember, a fully bearded, go there, picture it. Well, I was temporarily stunned and terribly self-conscious. But in the twinkling of an eye, Jesus set me free from propriety. I buried my lips into Elam's and returned his kiss with the same enthusiasm. Then he jumped down, wrapped both his hands around my right arm, and led me on a tour of the farm. About a half hour later, Elam sat next to me at lunch. Midway through the meal, I turned around to say something. Inadvertently, my right elbow slammed into Elam's ribcage. He didn't wince, he didn't groan. He wept like a two-year-old child. His next move undid me. Elam came over to my chair, planted himself on my lap, and kissed me even harder on the lips. Then he kissed my eyes, my nose, my forehead, my cheeks. And there was Brennan, dazed, dumbstruck, weeping, suddenly seized by the power of a great affection. In his utterly simplicity, little Elam was a picture of Jesus Christ. Why? Because at that moment, his love for me did not stem from any attractiveness or lovability in me. It was not conditioned by any response on my part. Elam loved me whether I was kind or unkind, pleasant or nasty. His love was a picture of grace. What's amazing is the God of the universe loves you like that. And that's why he went to such trouble, to be in intimate relationship with you. So how does this happen? Last two verses in our text. For it is by grace, unmerited favor, you've been saved through faith. This is not from yourselves, it's the gift of God, not by works, so that no one can boast. It is by faith through grace. That means you put your trust in Jesus Christ to save you because of his gracious gift. It means you come to Jesus and say, I believe what you did on the cross was for me. I believe when you shed your blood, it can wash my sin away. I believe that in some miraculous way, I was included with you in the cross. So I died with you. I was buried with you. And now I can be raised to new life with you as well. And you can come and live within me and I can start over. I believe it. Lord Jesus, do that in me right now, I pray. That's faith. This morning, the first thing I did when I woke up, it was very, very early this morning, I tweeted. I'm a Twitterer now. And my tweet was pretty simple. It said, he is risen, I'm up too. And if you had seen it early in the morning, what you might have thought I was saying was, he is risen, I've gotten out of bed. It's not what I meant. What I meant was, he is risen, I've been risen too. And this, my friends, is the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. Not only has he been risen, but you can rise to new life as well. Would you please stand? I want to pray for you, and then we're going to respond with musical worship. I want to pray a simple prayer. If you want to receive this free gift of salvation today, if you want this to be the day you pass from death to life, pray in the quietness of your own heart after me these words. Lord Jesus, I believe you're God. I believe you're alive. I believe you lived as a man on earth. I believe you died, shedding your blood for me. I believe you can wash my sin away. Please do it now. I believe you can raise me to new life. Please give me new life now. I believe you want to live inside me. Live inside me now, Jesus. And change me from the inside out. And Lord, for those of us who know you and love you and have walked with you for some time, this day we celebrate the resurrection life of Jesus that has made everything brand new, all based in your amazing grace. Let's sing of it together.